वेलकम टू द वीडियो लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ क्रिप्टोग्राफी एंड नेटवर्क सिक्योरिटी। आई एम योर इंस्ट्रक्टर डॉक्टर रमेश प्रजापति एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द X.509 सर्टिफिकेट्स। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विथ एजेंडाज। द फर्स्ट X.509 सर्टिफिकेट, सेकेंड ऑथेंटिकेशन प्रोसीजर। सो लेट्स सी द फर्स्ट इज द X.509 सर्टिफिकेट्स। So, the X.509 certificates provide the authentication service and defines authentication protocols. And we have seen the authentication. Authentication means verify the user's identity. It means if there are two users, user A and user B, if user A want to communicate with user B, before starting the communication, they should mutually authenticate to each other. So, if you are considering two users, user A and user B, user A want to communicate with B, so user A should authenticated by user B, and user B it should be authenticated by user A. After completion of this authentication, mutual authentication process, it start the communication. So, how to achieve this mutual authentication between two users? So, there are various ways to achieve the authentication, mutual authentication. The one of the way is X.509 certificates. As you know, there are two types of keys, the public key and the private key, as formed as a pair. Now, the one of the key is used for encryption, the other key for the same pair should be used for the decryption. And every user will be having the own private key and the public key. The public key will be available for all the users in the network, and the private key is not sellable. One user want to communicate with other user, that user should be have a public key of other users. Now we have seen the different types of public key distribution. And the public key is stored in one directory. Now, who is maintain this all the public key? And so the certificate authority maintain all the public key. Now, X.509 certificate, it is also called the digital signature. That means, the X.509 certificate is a digital certificate that uses a widely accepted international X.509 public key infrastructure, it is also called the PKI standard, to verify that the public key belongs to user, computer or service identified contained within the certificate. If any user want the certificate, so the certificate will be issued by only the certificate authority. Any user send their public key and the user identity to certificate authority. Now it verify the public key of user and the identity of user. Now the X.509, it provide the X.500 directory. This directory is responsible to provide the certificate in a one directory or in one place. Now any user can access the certificate from that directory or that place. Now here the X.500, it is the one directory, and in that directory we can store the two things. The first, the public key certificate, and second is a public key of user signed by the certificate authority. First, the public key certificate and the public key of user signed by the certificate authority. These two things will be stored in the X.500 directory. Now, the X.509 is based on the use of public key cryptography. It is also called the public key cryptography. And in public key cryptography, we have seen the RSA algorithm. And the X.509 is also called the digital signature. Now, let's see the format of X.509. In X.509 format, the number of fields are there. So here, the first field, the version. Every certificate will be having the different version. And this version gives which version are using in the certificate. There are various types of versions are there. Version 1, version 2 and the version 3. And the difference between this version are only in the field. Right? In a version 1, the some fields are used. In a version 2, the some extra fields are used in the version 2, and the version 3 are used all the fields. Which the version 1 and version 2, the number of fields are available in a version 1 and version 2, that all the fields are used in a version 3. Now, next is a certificate serial number. Certificate serial number, the certificate generated by the certificate authority, it will give the unique serial number to each and every certificate. Now, the next is the algorithm parameters. Next field is called the algorithm parameters, and the combination of this, the pair of this, called the signature algorithm identifier. It will use the algorithm to generate the signature. The next is the issuer name. Issuer name, it means, as you know, the certificate authority will generate the certificates. So we can say that certificate authority name is called the issuer name. Now, not before and not after, and this pair is called the proof of validity or the period of validity. It consists of two fields, the first and the last. First and last, the certificate is valid from which date and expire in which date. It means it provides the validity of the certificate. Now, the next is a subject name. The subject name is referred as a user name. Next is a algorithm parameters key. It is also called the subject public key information. In this, we provide a public key along with the user's identity to certificate authority. Now, this all the field is considered in a version 1. Now, the next is your unique identifier. Every certificate authority there will be one unique identifier number. Same the subject unique identifier is all the users, we should provide the unique identifier number. This all the fields we are considering in the version 2. Now version 1, we are considering the field up to the subject public key information. In the version 2, we can consider the extra two field, issuer unique identifier and the subject unique identifier. Now the next is an extension. It means if you want to use the extra field, we require the extension. Now up to the extension, the start from the version 2 extension, this all the field will be considered in a version 3. So I already told you the version 1, version 2 and version 3. all this, the difference between all this version are the failed. Now the next algorithm parameters encrypted hash, it is also called the signature. So finally we will generate the signature, means the signature will be created and the signature will be appended with the user's public key and user's identity. Now the signature is also encrypted using the hash code. So this is all about the format of X.509. It means if certificate authority will generate the certificates, it include in the certificate, it include all the fields. Now the signature will be used for all the version. It means if you are considering a version 1, version 2 and version 3, the signature will be used in all the version. Now so this is all about the X.509 format. Now this is the explanation, the version first, the second is the certificate issuer. Certificate must assign a serial number and it distributes it from the other certificate. It means all the certificates should be unique. Now the next is the signature algorithm identifier, and this signature algorithm identifier by issuer to sign the certificate. It means here we will use the algorithm, we will use the algorithm to generate the signature. Now the next is the issuer name. The certificate authority name is considered as a issuer name. Now the next is a period of validity. It consists of two dates, the first and the last, on which the certificate is valid. Now the next is the subject name. The subject name is name of the user. The subject public key information. In this field, we can consider the two things, the public key along with the user's identity. Now the next is issuer unique identifier. To identify the uniquely the issuer issuing the certificate authority. Now the next subject unique identifier, identify the uniquely the subject name. In the issuer unique identifier, we identify uniquely the issuing the certificate authority. In a subject unique identifier, to identify the uniquely the subject name. Now the extension, the set of one or more extension field. Now the next is a signature. The it consists on it in signature contains the hash code of the other field encrypted with the certificate authority's private key. It means the signature is only encrypted using the certificate authority private key, and this field includes the signature algorithm identifier. Right, this field, the signature field, is included in the signature algorithm identifier. Now the next is how to generate the signature. So here you can consider one user, BOM's identity and the BOM's public key will be sent to the certificate authority. And the first time there are two fields, it contains the user ID and the user's public key. Now this is the unsigned certificate. We are applying the hash algorithm on both the field. After applying the hash function, it generating the hash code. Again the hash code will be encrypted using the private key of certificate authority. Now after encryption, it generating the hash code. It means it is the signature, and the signature is appended with the BOM's identity along with the public key. Now the signed certificate, you can see in the center the signed certificate it contains the BOM's ID bonds public key and the certificate authority information. That means this is whole this box, it represents the signed certificate. Now in the receiver side, in other side, those person who have the public key of certificate authority will decrypt the signature. Now in the decrypt the signature, in this signature first apply the decryption along with the certificate authority public key. After applying the decryption, it will get the hash code. Now bonds ID information and the bonds public key, we apply the hash algorithm. After applying the hash algorithm, it generating a hash code. Now compare the both the hash code. If the both the hash code are equal, that means the signature is valid. So this is the scenario to generate the signature. Okay, so here the recipient can verify the signature by comparing the hash code. If both the hash code are equal, that means the signature is valid. So this is all about the generating a signature. Now the next topic, authentication procedure. We all know that what is authentication. Now so there are various types of authentication procedure are used in a X.509. So the X.509 support the three types of authenticating using the public key signature. Again we are considering the public key signature over here. Now the three types of authentication are, the first is the one way authentication, second two way authentication, and three way authentication. So let's see the first one way authentication. So in one way authentication, the single transfer of information from one user to other user. It means that if we are considering a two user, user A and user B. Now user A want to communicate with user B. So the first, user A send the information to second user, and here we are considering the only the single transfer between the user A and the user B. Now let's see the scenario. Now user A and user B, user A want to communicate with user B. So user A send the one message to user B. Now here one way authentication, it means user A should not authenticated by user B. So here in the message included the A is, it means this message is sent by the user A, and in this message is included the TA means timestamp. TA represent the timestamp of user A, and the timestamp is identify when the message has been generated. It means it provide the generation time and the expiration time of the message. Timestamp is used to prevent the delay of sending the message. Now the second parameter RA, it means represent the nonce. Nonce are represented as a unique value, and the nonce is prevent replay attack. It prevent the replay attack. The next IDB means identity of user B. The signed data, SCN data, it means the signed data which is signed by the users is private key. Now the KAB is mid session key or secret key, and A, it means user A, B means user B. So KAB is encrypted using the public key of user B. PUB represents the public key of user B. Now the message sent to the user B. Now here this message authenticates the identity of A to B and the integrity of message. Integrity of message means the message should not be altered during the transmission. So we have to also check So user A should check the authentication and the integrity of the message. Now you can see the message is written in a double curly bracket. Then SGN data is the information that needs to be conveyed. TA represents the timestamp and RA is the nonce. So here only user A is authenticated person, right? And it's sent to the user B. It means it is also called a one-way authentication. Now, second two-way authentication. Two-way authentication allow the both the party to communicate and verify the identity of each other. It means we have seen in the authentication, if two party want to communicate with each other, so before starting the communication, they should mutually authenticate. It means here in this scenario, the both the party should authenticate to each other. It means user A and user B. User A want to communicate with user B, so user A send the message to user B, and the message included the timestamp, nonce is created by user A, ID B, user identity, signature data, the sign done by the user's A is private key, and the KAB is session key is encrypted using the PUB, is the public key of user B. Now same, now here user A is authenticated user B. Now user B want to authenticate user A, so again the user B send the reply message to user A. So here user B is included the from user B side, the message included the TB means transaction, means timestamp created by B, nonce is also created by B, IDA user identity, identity of user A, signed data which is signed by the user B's private key, and the KBA, it means the session key is encrypted using the public key of user B. So this is called the two-way authentication. It means here you have to authenticate the two users. User A should be authenticated user B, and user B is authenticated to user A. So that's why it is called a two-way authentication. Now the next is a three-way authentication. In a three-way authentication, the synchronized clock are not available. So let's see the scenario first. There are two users, user A and user B. User A want to communicate with user B, so the first user A should authenticate the user B with this message, and in this message it included the timestamp, nonce which is created by user A, IDB, identity of user B, signed data which is signed by the user A's private key, and the KB, the session key, KB is a session key will be encrypted using the public key of user B. Now the same user B also authenticated to user A, so again send the message to user A, and user B create the message, and in this message it included the timestamp and nonce which is created by user B, IDA, identity of user A, signed data which is signed by the user B's private key, and the KBA, that means the secret key or the session key will be encrypted using the public key of user B. Now here the nonce, we use the nonce. Nonce means to prevent the replay attack. So here in both the side, user A side and user B side, both the side we only consider the nonce, because the by nonce is identify the replay attack. We prevent the replay attack, we can say that. So again user A send the message to user B, and in this message it included the A of RB. are we a representative nonce, and this nonce is created by user B. So here user A also reply the message to user B, that means, and in the reply message is sent the nonce. Means nonce, it identify the, or it prevent the replay. In this scenario, the synchronized clock are not available. So this method include the additional message from A. So now I hope you clearly said it. Thank you.